We are more suitable for men than we are for women. The floor is yours. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Dr. Katelijn Jonker.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation to be here. I'm especially interested in Maastricht because in our yearly visits to the various boards of the universities and KNAW and NWO, etc., Maastricht stood out. And I think that's also a clear sign of why this particular morning, this program, has been organized here by Maastricht. And Maastricht really approaches from a different point. And they said, well, you know, we've come a long way, and I'll show some of the figures so you know already in advance that you can be proud to be here in Maastricht. But still, we still have so much more work to do. And we're so happy that you're here because now we can talk about it and see if there are more ideas of how to improve things. Well, okay, that was a fantastic interaction. And then they followed up by this event. Isn't that amazing? So, yes, I'm really flabbergasted and proud and happy to be here. And I would like to connect first to your talk, Tina, because you said, what would you do if you weren't afraid? I don't know, because typically I'm afraid all the time. You know, I don't know if you have that as a speaker, but you sit there, you know, the time that your time is coming up. You feel your heart rate racing, you know, sweat breaks out. You think suddenly, oh, what am I going to say? Am I going to stick to what I originally intended to say? Or will I do as I did today? Change it because you saw something, you heard something which impressed you. So thank you for impressing me, Tina, with that. Also, thank you to Ursula for impressing me because of the several things in the mentoring, but also the first thing, like the banging on the table and things like that. I've did the martial arts, so I know how to bang. But the thing that I was most proud of was the first, say, mental fight that I won at a university by being silent. I used to be so intimidated by these guys, you know, saying, like, banging with their fists and telling me that this is, of course, the right way to do it. And I would be there like, yeah, maybe they know. And the fight I won, the first fight that I really won in that sense, was first just saying, no, I don't agree. And then whatever he said, I just stared back. He rambled on for like 5 minutes. And then he said, well, maybe you're right. Yes! So I came back to my martial arts teacher that week and said, yes! I think I know now why I came and did martial arts. So I didn't intend to say this at all. So sorry in that sense, but I was supposed to talk about all these elements. First, of course, to feed you a little bit with extra facts and figures about the Netherlands. So some of the figures that you'll see were also presented already by Ursula, but I'll have some more. And I'll tell you something about the actions that the network is taking and some bit more about research that we want to do, and that I think is a nice setup for the next speaker, Professor Ellemers. So first a bit more about the figures. You've seen this picture. But this is 2002 and 2010. So the picture that was shown by Ursula was 2007, I think. Mm-hmm. And this is 2002 and 2010. Well, let me see if I can find the indicator. Yes. Belgium, Cyprus, Luxembourg. And indeed, Germany is also not that far ahead, but still, they made a huge improvement here, right? So that's nice. So that we're so happy that we're here, people also from Germany, that we can learn from how to do this. But there is something weird going on here in the Netherlands. So I think culture has to be part of the discussion of today. And since culture is something of all of us, we cannot talk about it with just women. We'll have to talk about this together with our male colleagues. So I'm very happy to see so many male here as well. Okay, then the scissor. You've also seen this scissor, the leaky pipeline, as it's called, also for 2 years, 2002 and 2012. So yes, we made improvement because we see the blue line going down a bit, and the reddish lines going up a bit, which is nice. You see here also that we start a little bit different figure than Ursula showed you. We start with students. It's still okay at the graduate level. PhD levels is the first point where it goes wrong. And then here we have the full professors. Now here in the Netherlands, we have been banging our fist on the table with respect to the full professors. And we've made improvements, really helped. Everyone is aware of it. The rectors are really full on top of looking into who is appointed as a full professor. Has there been enough attention to gender? Why wasn't a woman appointed? Did we have the right advisory committee in terms of people that are aware of gender diversity problems, etc.? And so one of the things that the network is advocating now is that we also pay a lot of attention here, because most of the Netherlands has switched to a tenure track system. And in this tenure track system, the appointments that we make there basically determine who will get here, right? And now the tenure track assistant professorships appointments are not so closely monitored by the boards of our university. So I'm quite intrigued also by the things that you said, Tina. It has to come from the bottom up. Well, we are bottom up because we are the female full professors in the Netherlands, and we did unite, and we do something about it. But we so much need these boards, the higher, the top-down approach, to make sure that real emphasis and attention is being placed at those points, and also now to call attention for where the pipeline approximately starts. And of course, that also holds for the PhD students, but okay. This is a figure that it might be interesting for you and will make you proud here in Maastricht. Yeah, Maastricht is doing well, third place. Fantastic. So keep this moment, because next slide is going to disappoint you a bit. But still, try to keep it in mind. And also compare it, for example, to the university I currently work for, Delft University of Technology. I'm very happy also to work in Delft. We're doing great things for women. And we see some improvements, a little bit. Yes, true. It is a difficult area. Now, of course, these differences between types of universities, you see technical universities typically dangling at the bottom, is of course something which is also reflected in this figure. And this is why I still want you to not just be proud of Maastricht, but also to be aware that we still have a major problem at our hands. If we're going for proportionate representation of genders in the different areas, then hey, 25%, well, we are not there yet, but say 20%, wow, yeah? The difference is one-third, one-fourth or worse. And that still holds also in the technology aspects, right? So even though we have only a few women, we could have many more. We could go for the 20% there. Should we go for proportionate? Or should we go for 40% at least for both genders over all professions? For me, that's still something I debate. I know as president of the network of female professors, we say we go for proportionate, so I want then in that case, what is it? More than 60% in language and culture to be female professors. Yeah, but I am for diversity, so I'd rather have that. Well, like to debate with you about that later on. Then this. Now, I'm a bit hesitant, actually, to show you this, because this is the most positive, optimistic extrapolation that we can make of the data. I think it's so wrong, actually. And it's supposed to give you a pessimistic view, because, you know, only by 2058 will we have this proportionate stuff here. But it's not true. These curves don't go like that. I mean, any of you who have done some experiments in that sense will know that it will basically taper off, right? And there's another problem here. the universities told me, well, actually, yes, we did appoint more women, but we also appointed way more male. Sorry. You know, there are more professors in the Netherlands. So something has to be done there as well. So it's not, it's optimistic, it's pessimistic. I don't know what to make of it, actually. So you tell me what you think. Okay, now, but we want this increase, so how do we get about it, and what does the network do? So now we switch to really what is the activities of the network. First of all, is to get these figures out, to know what we were telling about. And this we do together with Stichting de Beauvoir. And this monitor we get about in 2 years, every 2 years, and some updates in between. And it's a huge work to get this data. And it is so important to stimulate the discussion. So that's what we do. We do the monitor. But we also basically have these four activities, levels of activities. Monitor policy making and change the institutions for which we visit all those boards and things like that. To empower women and male scientists by mentoring programs, by intervention, by pump your career events, by all kinds of gatherings that we can do. Provide the figure statistics and knowledge, for which, of course, the monitor is absolutely essential. And to raise awareness, one of the reasons that I'm, of course, here today. So engage in discussions and talk about it. So that's, in general, what we do. And within those lines of activities, we chose a number of focus points for the next time. One of those focus points is, as I said earlier, culture. If we want to change culture, we'll have to do it together with the whole population. So not only talk to females in the boards, but talk to all the males in our vicinities, raise awareness there, and solve it together, because this is a joint problem. Second focus that we chose is to do internationalization. So, again, I'm very happy that Germany is represented here today to give their input on this same problem and to see what we can learn from what they did and how they changed the policies. Which of those policies implemented in, for example, Germany would actually work in the Netherlands? What's the difference between those cultures? What will make it work and what will be a hindrance? The last thing, basically already there, is that we want to invest more in research on the topic. So sometimes research is initiated from people who show particular interest and do that, or it's initiated top-down from policymakers who want to know how things are going. But we as a network want to do this bottom-up thing. So if we hear from, for example, the local networks that there is some problem at the university, we don't just listen to it as being something of this or that university, but is there maybe an element which is better dealt with if we look at it, if we research it from the national perspective? And so we have a standing invitation to all people on the work floor, but also, of course, to the boards of the universities, that if they think there is a problem or a potential problem that might not be local, then to give it to us, and we'll see if we can find the resources to do the research. And in that particular way, the last year we focused on these three research topics. First one is the tenure trackers. In the tenure track is something interesting of the Netherlands that we tend to do as the US does, and then of course do it differently, not just change the name, but basically make it so different that people, well, we didn't change the name, did we? So we raise expectations that it's about tenure track, and then we do it so differently that people still have the same expectations as they would have as they would look to the US, and then find out that it's different. And we got many, many complaints about the tenure track, particularly from our female colleagues, young female colleagues. And I was astonished because I believed in it. I thought, wow, this tenure track stuff is a great opportunity. You have like 5 years to prove yourselves, and then only after that period you'll have your judgment. I'm sure that will appeal to women. Well, wrong. It's 5 years of insecurity. It's 5 years at a period where you also want to think about how you're going to deal with family versus work. Do you want to have a family? Do you want to buy a house? Things like that. All these things are more difficult if you don't have tenure yet. So thank you very much, Katulijn, for proposing this and stimulating this. So sorry. So is this really a problem? So we figured it out. Well, we had other people figure it out for us. Professor Demaruti and her colleagues looked into it, and they found that indeed there is a problem there. That both male and females think that the tenure track as it's currently implemented is unclear. It's unclear what they should do to get tenure. They find it rather fixed. So they'd like to see more adaptation to personal circumstances. And, well, they feel uncertain about it. If you ask tenure trackers at the beginning, will you make it? Then, hey, there's this stereotype. Males will say, yes. Females will say, don't know. If we look at the end, there's no difference. So that's a good thing, right? But if you look at these insecurities about the uncertainties of how things are presented, males versus females, then the females are more bothered by it. So in a sense, although it's difficult for everyone, it's perceived as more difficult for women. And that's, of course, a difficult thing, because you should use all your energy to put in that work, instead of putting half of your energy, say, into dealing with this uncertainty, right? So if we can reduce that, I think we can. And when talking to the boards of the universities, I got very optimistic results, also from the HR officers, that of course there's more possible there. We can make it more clear. We can make more personal agreements on what you should achieve for your tenure. So fight for it. Ask for it. Be clear about it. Other things that we did is the legal limitations and opportunities for temporary special arrangements. In particular, the preferential treatment to enhance the percentage of women professors. Well, you know the fellowship in Groningen, which was challenged for the Committee for Equal Rights, Equal Opportunities, because it wasn't open for men. And then Delft wanted to do the same thing. But Delft was, of course, warned by what happened with Groningen. And so Delft got Ben Sloot to help them with preparing for that. And he found out under which circumstances you're allowed to make these special arrangements. So if you want to do something like this, please read it. It's all there for you. And use it. And you can. Then, a last one, gender imbalance on executive and supervisory boards of Dutch universities and university medical centers. Interesting point, of course, because if you have a board of three and you have one female on it, you have 30%. That's good, right? If you lose that one female, you're down to zero. So, law of the small numbers. So I want to finish this talk by just saying we're open to more research here, and we're looking forward to the interaction with you. We're looking forward to interacting with our male colleagues, particularly to improve the situation in the Netherlands. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Dr. Katelijn Jonker. Thank you very much for sharing the latest data, because it's always very important to know what we are talking about exactly.